1 John chapter 4, it says, we love him because he first loved us. I want to let you know, if you want to have a great prayer life, it starts with this, not focusing on having great prayer life. It's focusing on having a love relationship with God. And to have a great love relationship with God, the focus is not on having great love relationship with God. It's focusing on his great love for you. When you come to prayer, do not be impressed with your love for God. Do not be depressed with the lack of it for God. Be blessed by God's great love for you. There is a story that's worth constantly repeating in the Bible. And it's the two disciples who serve as a contrast. One disciple was Peter, who constantly focused on his love for Jesus. And he struggled in his relationship with God for a while. Because there was a time he would beat his chest and promised he will never leave Jesus. And he did try his best. When the servant would come, he would take a knife and chop this guy's ear off. I mean, that's a pretty high moment. Great allegiance. Peter's about to get locked up in jail for his devotion to Jesus. Great zeal, great passion. I mean, Peter tried to impress everybody with how great his love is for Jesus. And he always went from up to down, down to up. No constancy. And then there was another disciple, his name is John. And John always referred to himself in his diary or his description of Jesus's life as a disciple Jesus loved. It sounds a bit arrogant, cocky, and kind of self-conceited when you describe yourself as a person whom Jesus loved. But John, it doesn't say John did not love Jesus. It doesn't say that Jesus loved John more than others. It just simply means that John decided to, he looked at his love for Jesus. He says, it's this. He looked at Jesus's love for him and it was so great. He says, you know what? I'm not impressed with this. I'm impressed with that. And I will live my life with the awareness of how big his love is for me. And at the time when Peter is cutting people's ears off and Peter is cursing the girl and saying, I don't even know who Jesus, who is that? John is standing right before Jesus, who's dying on the cross with his mother. And Jesus, at the last moments of his life, when Peter is over there cursing and denying Jesus, John is receiving the last piece that Jesus has on this earth. The clothes were already divided. So the only thing Jesus had left is his mother. And guess who Jesus gives his mother to? Not to a man. I love Jesus. I will kill for Jesus. And curse and deny him too. He didn't give him his mother to that man. He gave his mother to a man. You may say, Jesus, you're trusting your mother to a guy? You don't even know if he really loves you. No, no, no. Any man who focuses on my love for him will always love me. I will give him my mother and my mother will receive him as her son. Why? Because a man who lives with the awareness God loves me will always find fuel to love him back. A man who lives only with the awareness, I must love God. I'm not loving God hard enough. I need to repent and pray. I need to focus harder on my love for God. That man will be like Peter. One day you're going fasting for 10 days and the other day you're watching porn. One day you're going so radical for Jesus Christ and another day you're barely scraping up energy to get up to climb to church because you missed it for 3 weeks in a row. And why is that inconsistency? Because your love cannot sustain you for God. Your love is fragile. Your love is small. You can only love God to the degree that you know his love for you. We love him because he first loved us. When you come to prayer every morning, I want you to come with this awareness. God is not mad at me. So anytime you feel like God is mad at you, it's not God. It's Satan. But he lies to you and tells you that that's God. God is not mad at you. You may think God is trying to punish you. He already did that on the cross 2,000 years ago. But it's the enemy who wants to attack you. Until we understand the depth of God's love for us, we will never understand Satan's fierceness against us. When you know that God loves you so much, then it makes sense why Satan would attack you. If Satan would want to get revenge and get back at God for everything God did to him and for all the hate that he has toward God, he knows he can't go to heaven and attack God. He knows he cannot attack nothing. The only thing he found with God is this. God has a weak spot. When I say a weak spot, it means God has a vulnerable spot in His heart. He loves humans, and humans are on the earth. If I want to mess with God, I mess with His kids. So the reason Satan will attack you fiercely is because God loves you deeply. And Satan, let me just make a few things clear. The difference between me and you is this. I've committed sin, you've committed sin. You're going to hell and I'm going to heaven. The difference between me and you, Satan, is that I was as messed up as you were. The only thing is God loved me so much, it gave His Son, and He doesn't like you at all and He's sending you to hell. That is the difference. And so you can stand and accuse me of my past, but I'm just going to stand and remind you of your future. Because where you're headed, I'm not going with you. He reminds you of many times that God doesn't love you. Remind Him that, listen, it's you who God doesn't love. And you think because He doesn't love you, He doesn't love me. Oh yes, He loves me. He proved that on the cross. God is not mad at you. God loves you. It's the enemy who is mad.